Good afternoon, everybody. Let's start with the presentation. So I hope everybody have joined and everybody is able to view the PPT slides. To start with, I will be talking about first the personal development and then the emotional development. And then I would request you all to write the questions, whichever you have. And then end of the session, we'll have the brainstorming time wherein I can clarify all your questions. Is that fine?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
So let's start with the personal and emotional development. Yes. Personal development has important domains such as emotional, mental, physical, spiritual, and social. Personal development is very important to everybody. As we all know, as adults, we always want to develop ourselves. We want to put our best foot forward. So this is very important area wherein we'll start from the mental development. So when we start with the mental development refers to all the mental ability, everything that we do mentally, that is attending, perceiving, observing. Excuse me. I'm sorry. Yeah, so let's get back, maybe some sort of disturbance. So mental development refers to the mental abilities like attending, perceiving, observing, remembering, imagining things, problem solving skills, and also how we use our language, our communication. So mental development is very important. So it starts from infancy. It starts from infancy, and there are six keys to help our mental development. So to help aid our mental development, the first I would like to discuss is the social connections. As we all know that we all human beings are social animals, and we need our social connections to connect with the society and with the people of the society. And this keeps our mental well-being, because if we have our relationships doing well at home, we are fine. That's how we are mentally balanced. And then the second is the staying active. We are doing 9-to-5 job, but then after that, if we are not active, like not exercising, or if you are not educating ourselves, if you are not doing other things, so tend to set back. So being active is very important at any stage of adulthood. Then there's something very important these days, and also the reason for many diseases, that's called stress. So we all are stressed out at the end of the day, let it be the work, let it be home, let it be relationships. So now we need to educate ourselves how to manage stress. So managing stress is also very important these days. So we'll be talking about it later in the later slide. Then there's something called brain healthy diet. So we need to have a healthy diet, less of sugar, less of carbohydrates, and less of fatty foods to make our mind very alert and clear. The more sugar we eat, the more dull we become. Then the other thing which aids mental health is quality sleep. 7 to 8 hours of sleep as an adult is very important. So sleep quality is very, very important in adulthood to efficiently do our work and to stay healthy mentally and physically. Then the next thing is meaning and purpose to life. Whatever work we are doing, whatever job we are doing it. And we think, why are we doing it? We need to sit and think. We need to add a purpose to it, a meaning to it. Then only we will be able to perform to our fullest. So this is Yeah, so the basic thing to enhance a mental development through starting through your diet and your physical exercises. It goes with having greens, having fish, berries. We all have tea and coffee time to time to be alert in our meetings and in our workshops. That's the common thing we Indians do. So, right. So next is the physical development. The physical development refers to the process where the development that starts in human infancy and continues into late adulthood, late adolescent, concentrating on all the fine and the gross motor skills. Fine and gross motor skills are the muscular skills, what we do. So physically, if we are fit, physically we are healthy, we tend to perform well at our job place, plus in all our roles, being the family, being the job place. The next is the social development. This is a very important development. This refers to our relationship with other people around in the society and the society itself. And it refers to improving the well-being of every individual in the society so that they can reach the full potential. So we need to help ourselves, plus we need to help the people around us in turn benefiting the whole society. So that's what social development refers to. So doing good to people, their own families, is in turn benefiting the society. Developing social skills and emotional maturity is very, very important aspect of personal development. Now, there's some tips to improve your social skills. It's how you make others feel. Like, we're all social animals. We want to interact. We stay in groups. We want to interact. We have groups at our workplace. We have a family. We have marriage. There's in another institution. So we are technically surrounded by people. And we need to understand and be aware of how how we need to improve our social skills. So to start with first, it's how you make others feel when you talk. It's not the words which people remember, it's the feeling that you make them feel. For example, when you're I suppose we have all the professors and the assistant professors here listening. So when you're taking a class, when you're passing on the information to your juniors, to your students. So sometimes we pass on the information, making them feel inferior, or you don't know this much, or you don't know that much. So the feeling remains with the person. So as mature adults, we need to be more responsible of how we're using our words, so how the other person is feeling. And then the other tip is, when you're walking into a huge classroom or when you're walking into a huge hall of people to give a workshop or whatever, if you feel that you have a side wherein you're very shy, the best thing what you could do is you can get a little early up there so that you are aware of the environment, you get comfortable over there. And also the next thing is, take the lead. Now, many of the social situations, people want to just sit back and follow the instructions. The very few who would just get up and take the responsibility to post or do whatever it is. So it's very important skill to take the lead, to get up and initiate the process. Then the another thing to improve your social skill is the small talk. Small and clear talk is very important. See, we all sit, we all chit chat, we go hours together talking without any outcome coming out of it. So we need to do more clear, short and sweet talk with people so that it's more clear and it's more understandable. So that's also a very important social skill which people have to learn. Then getting a feedback. Now, this is a very tricky one because people, especially we Indians, we take it on very personally when it comes to feedback. But this is very important, and I request everybody to be very conscious about it. See, there's a very fine line between complaining and a feedback. So when it comes to feedback, we need to be open. What people are saying about us, what our colleagues are saying about us, what our students are saying about us, what's the management saying about us, so that we could build accordingly. So taking a constructive feedback and working on it is very, very important for our personal growth and for our own improving our own social skills. Then the next one is how to learn to wrap up. We talk, but then we don't even realize and we don't even wrap up and we forget the point of the conversations generally. So it's very important to have clear talks and also very important to wrap it up nicely with people so that there's no incomplete feeling in there. So technically, for example, when we have a conversation, whatever it is, we need to reciprocate saying that, okay, I understand this, and this is how you want me to do, and thanks for the time, and I appreciate the feedback. So this is just an example how we could wrap up the conversations. So the next one is, it's not just about the content. Most of the time when we are doing lectures, or we all take classes, we have students, it's not just the content from the textbook. It's more to it. See, when we talk about just the content, we are just giving them the information from a book. But when we add experiences and examples and situations to it, and when we give that knowledge, that becomes more retainable. The people understand it very well. The other thing is be cool. Be cool in the sense it's not about being very stylish or fashionable, but then it means a lot about being more patient and being more calm. Like the people who would want to come and ask you n number of times the same questions because they're not able to understand, or maybe the people who would tell you something and forget and again come back and tell you. So you need to be calm to understand, and that's how you can improve your social skills. And also you need to continuously educate yourself to improve your social skills. And that also starts with, and that's an ongoing process, which is always when you're open to a constructive feedback, this goes on. Next is the spiritual development, the another domain of the personal development. This is a growth that allows a person to live in a very productive and satisfying life within the customs and regulations of the society. We all have our own spiritual side. We have our own religions. We have our own rules to follow where we feel very comfortable. We have our own customs and traditions where we feel very comfortable in it. So that's the spiritual development, which when you're comfortable, when you develop spiritually, that reflects in your personal development, that reflects in your personal growth. So I really like this quote. So I just wanted to put it in the slide that is so understandable and we can relate to it as in each individual develops in his own unique manner. As said, all five fingers are not same. Similarly, two individuals cannot be same. Every individual, let it be twins, let it be siblings, whatever it is, they have their own unique personality. They develop in their own unique manner. So there's some tips on enhancing personal development. Here, now first thing what we need to do is we need to self-discover. We need to identify our strengths, our weaknesses. We need to see that where we have all the positive sides which are helping us develop in a better way. For example, if I am punctual, that's a very good thing. That's my strength. If I am very empathetic, that's a very positive sign. That's the strengths. And weaknesses may be if I'm being very short-tempered, or if I am being very, not a very good listener. So we need is to start discovering our strengths and weaknesses, and then we should start working on it. So we need to take action on working on it. For example, now the next one is the self-assessment, learning about your skills, your personality, and your interests, and then how you do the assessment, how you assess them, and then action and goal setting. So you, after this awareness, after this assessment, what you need, what we generally have to do is we have to set our goals and take an action. We need to set smaller goals week by week, or maybe fortnightly or monthly, and then we should see the progress, wherein after 5 years, how we see ourselves, or after 2 years, where are we going to see, what degrees we're going to get, where we're going to do what. So this is how we need to set our goals, so that we develop personally, we move on and on. So here I end on the personal development and the growth. So can we all talk about it? If anybody has any doubts in the previous slides or anything, you can ask me before we go to the emotional development. Does anybody wants to ask anything? Any doubts or any kind of discussion?
Madam, I have a question, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, regarding this, what kind of food that we should take? Just you have mentioned that using of low sugar, something like that.
Yes.
So I think which food is the best food for us?
Yes, for us, I will tell you, as we are all into our adulthood, we don't need a lot of sugar and a lot of carbohydrates and fats. So the best food, what we have to do is, here are the five foods which I've written: lot of greens, fish, because it has a lot of omega 3 fatty acids, and berries, tea and coffee. We take a lot of caffeine to be alert all the time in our colleges and universities, and also walnuts. So this is the best thing: less of rice, less of roti, less of, I would say, sugar, sweets. Because that makes us very dull over the, because I'm sure if you realize in the morning you're more fresh, but then after the lunch, you start feeling very dull. You just don't want to take lectures, because we all go through that, because we take a lot of carbohydrates like rice and puri and roti. So cutting down on it makes us very alert, very clear-headed, and we'll be able to do our job very efficiently.
So what about the intake of oil, ma'am? Oil?
As less as you can.
Okay.
Yes.
So I think maybe we can wait for the participants.
Hello.
To... Yes. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Hello. I'm Mohammed Bahauddin from Malu City, Darbhanga. I want to ask one question.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. Ma'am, you have mentioned six keys to mental health. Okay, among six, there was staying active.
Yes.
I want a question. I want to ask a question regarding, is a hyperactive person should be treated as mentally healthy person? You mentioned just staying active. So,
yes.
Is a hyperactive person?
Okay.
Should be treated as mentally healthy?
Okay, that's a nice question. Staying active here, it means like when we are doing a 9-to-5 job, we are generally sitting, going, taking our lectures, coming back and sitting. Now staying active here means, what it means is exercising at least 40 minutes a day and trying to walk as much as you can and not sitting at one place. And also being mentally active, that is trying to read, trying to listen, or whatever. But then wherein what you've asked me of something called hyperactivity. Now, the hyperactivity is totally different from what I meant it over here. Okay? So now you have to be a little more clear to me that hyperactive is, what is your understanding towards it? Is the person taking too much caffeine, or is the person like, what is it?
What we observe usually in ADHD, attention deficit,
yes,
it's hyperactive person.
Yeah, but that's not relatable here, because now this.
That's why I've asked this question. Okay, yes. Thank you.
Yeah, so the hyperactive disorder, it's a disorder, so it doesn't come into being a mentally healthy thing. Here, staying active is having a very active lifestyle in general. I hope I've answered the question.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, I think
thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I think there is another question by Dr. Sahin Parveen, ma'am.
Okay.
What is the role of a teacher in enhancing emotional and social development? May I read once again, ma'am?
Yes.
What is the role of a teacher?
Yes.
In enhancing emotional and social development?
The role of a teacher in enhancing the social and emotional development of the child?
Yes.
Yes.
I think so. She has not mentioned.
Student, male students.
University students, particularly, child as well.
Okay, so ma'am, I would like to say that we've just finished the physical development. I have the other domains to discuss. So we have emotional and social development in the later slides. So I hope I would be able to answer there.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Sure, ma'am.
Right. So anything else regarding the mental health and the personal growth?
There are nearly 50 participants. Start speaking, participate. We're all university teachers.
Yes.
So I request to all the teachers to ask.
Be active.
Yes. It's a time, it's an opportunity to interact. Ma'am, there is another question by Yusuf Parvesab. How does a hypersensitive person balance his or her control?
Okay.
How does a hypersensitive person balance his or her control?
Control, I understand. He means that the somebody who is very emotionally sensitive, and how to balance the emotions, how to take control of the emotions, right?
Yes, I think so, ma'am.
Yes. So again, I would say that we have something called regulations of emotions, which is coming in the later slides. And after that, you can ask me again if you do not get the answer. Is that fine?
That's fine, ma'am. I think he says yes, fine.
Yes. So shall we go ahead, or any more questions till here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir, please.
Good afternoon. Yeah.
Good afternoon.
I have a question for you, ma'am.
Yes, please.
You clearly mentioned your presentation that that's true. Every one of us, especially when come to the students,
yes.
Those who are from university, they are all adult.
Yes,
and every one of us have a different persuasion,
absolutely,
different ability,
right,
and different thought.
Right.
And of course, we all come from different backgrounds, socially, absolutely, economically, and as well as.
Right.
So do you think medically, is there any exercise
mm-hmm.
which will allow the teacher to mm-hmm. enhance
mm-hmm.
the ability of students to think uniformly? The ability to think uniformly, because being a teacher, we have only one lesson. We have to convey that particular information to each and everyone. Of course, we will adopt different methods, different systems, but medically, is there any proven activity which will help teacher to take that activity and allow students to understand from various backgrounds?
Okay, now what I understood is you want me to answer your question, and what I understand is you're asking me, is there any medical way wherein we can make the students understand the same topic?
Yeah, exactly. You're right.
Coming from different backgrounds,
yeah,
with different socioeconomic statuses.
Yeah, perfect.
Right.
That's right.
To start with, technically, there's no medical exercise for making students understand, it's again, it all depends upon the teacher's creativity. See, we are all teachers, we are all facilitators technically. So we need, and as I told you, every personality is very unique. Like I would like to read this quote again, each individual develops in his or own unique manner. Majority of them have a normal IQ, average IQ, wherein when we deliver the information, it's understandable, but sometimes we need to alter our own approach. We need to work on our skills, the skills of our teaching and training to help the individual understand. We need to facilitate learning differently. So that's again, our responsibility. So there are different ways. I can, it's not included in this, but that I can cut it short and tell you because there are students who are more of the visual learners. Some students are more odd. They're like audible learners. They enjoy listening to lectures and understanding. But for some, if you show the video, they are more visual learners. If they see, they can understand well and then they can retain. So we have to alter our approaches to teaching. But there's no universal approach wherein we can just deliver one lesson and everybody can understand equally at the same level. Because everybody has different levels of IQs, different states of mind, different personalities. I hope I've answered the question.
Yeah, yeah, perfectly. Thank you, I appreciate that.
Most welcome. So anything else, or shall we start with the emotional development?
There is a question, ma'am, by Mr. Nisar Hussain, sir.
Okay. Does
being extrovert means more socially active person?
Absolutely right. Extrovert is a personality type wherein people are more social. They're able to strike conversations with everybody. They're more social. They can talk. They deal social situations very well. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am, you have answered.
Is it understandable? Anything else?
This is Dr. Rubina Khan from Manu Bhopal, CTE Bhopal. I have a question, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. In case of the social development, as you have answered this question, that the extroverts are the people who are more socially interactive people,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
So can we say that the students who are not socially active, means those yes. introvert students, we cannot, those in, introvert students yes. cannot be made to, I mean, how can we help those socially introvert students then?
Okay, so what I understood is you mean students who are introvert, how can we help them as teachers?
Yeah.
Yes. So technically, again, this is not the part of the topic for today. Maybe I can take another good presentation for this. But as teachers and as facilitators, we can always help them to talk, to express. Maybe after the class, we should be open. We can tell them, we can give them a chance to come and talk to us about their weaknesses and open up. So being available is most important for these kinds of students. And after time, some time, they'll start coming in and they'll start talking in, according to my experience. But then it's not advisable to force them in a full class to talk or to answer, because by nature, they're very introvert. By nature, they're being very shy. So slowly, slowly, they'll get out of the shell once they start feeling comfortable with you. So just being available for them helps a lot. I hope I've answered the question, Ms. Rubina.
Yes, ma'am, I think you have.
Let's get on to emotional development.
Sure, ma'am, please.
Yes. Now, the emotional development in adults is very, very important. And emotional development is, again, it is related to our emotions. Now these days, emotions emotions are how an individual deals with the matters and the situations they find personally important. So it can also be said as conscious mental reaction. You can see many emojis over here I've used. So emotions are technically the mental state. So if you're feeling happy, these are the basic emotions which we generally feel. That's happiness, sadness, fear, disgust, anger, and surprise. And also now these days, technology has no end. So we have so many emojis here, like we are using on our phone. It's like being tired or angry or cool or aggressive or zipping. So they're fun to use and show our emotions to whoever we are communicating with. Okay, so let's get down to emotional development. Emotional development refers to the ability to recognize our own emotions, then express our emotions and manage our feelings at different stages of life, and to have empathy for feelings of others. So this is what emotional development refers to. The development of these emotions include positive emotions and negative emotions, which are largely affected by relationships with parents, siblings, and peers. So now, there's something called emotional intelligence I would want to talk about. I'm sure most of you are available of a mental IQ, that's intelligence quotient. So similarly, we have emotional quotient. So emotional intelligence is also very, very important. So this is technically striking a very good balance between your heart and your mind. I got a very nice picture here which says that. I hope you all understand that. Yes, so emotional intelligence is the ability to identify our own emotions and those of others, to self-motivate ourselves and know how to monitor our emotions and those of the people around us. So now being emotionally intelligent refers to understanding our own emotions and also understanding what the person in front is feeling. And also the major chunk of emotional intelligence is managing our own emotions. Like if we feel extremely angry, extremely aggressive, how we control, how we manage. They're like, for example, there's some people who would just try to leave the situation and go outside when they feel extremely furious, extremely angry, or extremely irritated. They go out, they have a walk, come back, calm down, come back, and again start with their job or whatever it is. Every person has their own unique way of dealing with their emotions. And also how we use our emotions, even if we are extremely happy or even if you're extremely angry, especially in a professional setting, we do not choose to express very freely and openly. So that's how we try to manage our emotions, which is very important. So again, the emotional intelligence, largely it depends upon striking a very good balance between your heart and your mind. Like for instance, many of the people say, oh, I thought it was right and I did it, but I knew my heart didn't want to do it. And that's what the mistake was. And sometimes it's the reverse. They say, okay, I wanted to do, dil chaha maine kar liya. That's the thing they say, but the mind doesn't allow practically. So you need to be in sync on both the sides to deal with the things and effectively. So now let's see how people on low emotional intelligence are usually. So these are a few of the characteristics. So the people who are low on emotional intelligence, EQ, that is, they're very aggressive at the first place. They're not able to control their anger. They're very demanding. They want things, everything their way. They take things on their ego, very bossy. They will confront at the slightest of the second when things do not go their way. they're easily distracted. If they want to do something, but then let it be professionally, they let it be personally, they're easily distracted. The more selfish, they are very self-centered, they will think about themselves, and they're very poor listeners. They just want to be heard. They do not want to listen. They take very impulsive decisions, very emotional decisions, and they resist to change. Like now, as like adults, we know it's very important to be flexible. For example, I can take this situation because now, like I usually enjoy taking workshops, standing on a stage, having loads of people in the hall. But then now, because of COVID-19, I cannot do that. But being flexible and doing this, trying to change, that's accepting the change is important. If I do not accept change and if I'm not flexible, then that means I'm very low on my emotional intelligence, and that's how it becomes very difficult for people to survive. And also people with low EQ, they're very unresponsible, slow and stubborn. They do not pick up things fast or learn things fast. Most of them are very, very critical, very, very picky and fussy. They won't do anything. We have so many people, when I'm talking this, you all of you might relate some or the other person. Maybe they might be coming into your head, oh, this person is low on EQ. That's why this person is behaving like that. I'm sure everybody has some other person in their mind, or maybe ourselves too. Oh, I'm being like this. So maybe I need to work on this. So they're very critical, especially people who want to sit back, do not want to work, but then they will sit and they will criticize the other people who work. And they're very hard to please. No matter how much you do, they're never happy. And they try to be very perfectionist. And similarly, the people who are high on emotional intelligence, they're very assertive. Assertive meaning they know how to say no if they cannot do anything. And they're very ambitious. They're motivated to do things. They try different things. And they're very strong-willed. If they decide to do something, they want to do it in a positive way. And they're very charming and sociable and very warm. They're patient, stable, and they're very good listeners. And they're also very systematic and very neat because they want the life to go smoothly with their work, their home, their hobbies. They try to make a balance rather than being perfect in one way. They try to balance everything and work things in a very systematic way, wherein it's a very win-win situation for them. So now let's go in a little more detail about emotional development, where we were talking about self-awareness, empathy, motivation, self-regulation, and social skills. The self-regulation, again, we will discuss. I remember somebody asked me the question of how to regulate our emotions. So this is the thing which would be coming in. So how to improve your emotional quotient, how to improve your emotional health. It's again, the best way is to exercise, eat healthy, and work on our emotions. That's the best thing what we can do. So now, emotional intelligence, again, here we have to observe how you react to people. Now, to be aware, you need to understand that how you react, let it be students or colleagues or your own spouse or your children, see the time of the day, how you're reacting in your mornings, how you're reacting in your evenings when you're tired. So what's the thing you want to do about? Would you want to communicate clearly to your family that once I'm home, leave me for an hour or 2 hours because I'm drained? So that keeps the peace at home. You can say that, okay, after my work, I want to go for a walk for 40 minutes. That will bring a little bit of peace at home. And also it would relax you. Maybe you would want to listen to some kind of music to relax yourself. So switching on and off from your job to your home place is also very important. Now look at your work environment. If it's too stressful, if you're very stressed out or you're very frustrated or there's high levels of irritability all the time, You need to understand that what's going on at home or what's going on at the work environment, what's the triggers? What is triggering the irritability? What is the thing which is making you very frustrated or angry or whatever you're feeling? So trying to guess the triggers, trying to find out the triggers is very, very important. Now do a self-evaluation. You need to do a self-evaluation by understanding that if I feel very irritated by these things, is it okay? Or am I overreacting? And if I am overreacting, or if the person is judging you or having opinions about you wherein you're feeling irritated, so what's the solution to it? How would you deal with it? How would you evaluate? So that's what you need to do. And that's different from individual to individual, like one size doesn't fit all. Then examine how you react to stressful situations. Now, this is also what I said. Once you're back from your job, if you're very irritated or drained or tired, you can communicate with your family to leave you alone for 40 minutes, 1 hour or 2 hours or whatever it is. And you need to take the responsibility of yourself by taking some rest or whatever the actions you want to do to switch off from your work and get back home and get back to your original self. Then examine how your actions will affect others before you take those actions. There's also something which you need to be accountable for your behavior. Like every day, you cannot just go up to people or students or colleagues or anybody and start complaining or whining or saying, I have this issue and that issue. People people listen, and after a while, they'll stop listening. They'll stop ignoring, and that's what hurts a lot. So to improve your emotional intelligence, it is very important to work on yourself and realize your things and take accountability of your actions, and also to think that how your actions would affect the others in turn. Then self-awareness. People understand their emotions. Self-awareness, again, is a very important aspect of emotional intelligence. We are not aware. We are not aware of our own self. We try. It's a big battle. But once you start realizing your own strengths and weaknesses, once you start realizing, being self-aware, then it becomes very easy for you to deal with situations and people's and everybody around you. So self-awareness is people understand their emotions, they know what they're feeling, because generally when you ask somebody, how are you? Even if they're not fine, we are trained to say that I'm fine, thank you. But this is how our society and our education system and our traditions have trained us. So we have to understand emotions. And they don't let feelings rule them. Even if we are angry or even if we are dull, like look at the weather. If it's like too rainy and too, like the winters are like sometimes more depressive, but you don't want to wake up, go to work, but then we don't let our feelings rule us. We wake up, we dress up, we show up at the university because that's the job and that's how it has to be. Self-awareness is we don't let our feelings rule us. Then they're more confident. Once you're aware of yourself, how you're feeling, then you're more confident. When you know that talking to this person is triggering irritability, then you know how to talk and cut down your communication. So you become more confident. And they trust their intuitions and don't get out of control. So if the person is getting into an argument or if there's aggression, they'll start to shorten the conversation and they go away rather than getting out of control and having a heated argument. Now, another aspect is self-regulation. This is the ability to control our emotions, that is regulating ourselves. So the people who are good at it, they don't get angry or jealous easily. They know when they're feeling starting to get angry, they regulate their emotions, they get out of the situation, or they change the topic, or there are ways they deal with. Then they don't take impulsive and careless decisions. Sometimes, no matter how much angry we become, but people who are good at it, they regulate their emotions and they do not take impulsive and careless decisions wherein in future they have to pay a big price for it. And they think before they act. They're more flexible and they have the ability to say no. So that's something about regulating your emotions. And the other aspect is motivation. Now, motivation is like the very common word we've always been using, that, okay, I don't feel so motivated today to do my job or to do this or that. So technically, motivation is defined as a process that initiates, guides, and maintains goal-oriented behaviors. Motivation is what causes us to act in a certain way. It involves biological, emotional, social, and cognitive forces that activate our behavior. See, unless and until you're motivated to do a certain task, you will never want to do it. Force, that's what people say, forcibly, we cannot make people do things. People need to be motivated. So now, when people are motivated, higher degree of emotional intelligent people are usually motivated. They are very ambitious. They want to do the things which people say are impossible. They want to do where people say, the other people say, I can do it. They're highly productive. They love challenges. They're very active and effective in whatever they do. So motivation is a very important factor. Here are some of the ways to stay motivated. First is motivation is internal. You have to feel it within. Be your own coach. If you believe you will fail or succeed, you are right. So at the first place, we have to train our mind that, okay, I'm gonna do this and I'm gonna succeed in this. I'm gonna write this exam and I'm gonna get through it. You need to tell your own mind to feel motivated. So motivation starts internally first with you. And then remember what motivates you. Who are you doing this for? That's the most important questions. Keep reminder on your desk or whatever you're working towards. You can put the sticky notes on your desk, or you can put it on your, as a whatever, what do you say, on your lock screen, put it on it, put it everywhere, that why are you doing it? That keeps reminding you. Then challenge yourself with a daily goal. So if there is a big goal, you need to make small sub goals to achieve that one big goal. And what's one thing you must accomplish to make today as a success? So you need to challenge every day. And then motion creates emotion. So you have to get going and get active so that you can make things happen. You cannot sit at one place and say, I'm going to clear this exam. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. And I'm going to do this. But it's not going to work unless and until you get up and you do it. And also keep learning. Learners are earners. The more we learn, I'm sure during the lockdown and because of this COVID, technically we are all very sound now. I mean, there are many people who wouldn't have used technology so much in all their lives, which we've used in the last 6 to 8 months, I'm sure. So we need to keep learning. We need to be accepting to change. And also, this is a very important thing, hang out with superstars. It's the company matters. If you're hanging out with people who are very low on motivation and who are very lazy, who don't want to do things, you tend to become like that over a period of time. So choosing your company right is very important. If you're moving out or partying with people who are more goal-oriented, who are more motivated, more active, you tend to behave in a similar way. This has been proved. And also, after achieving something, if example, if you wanted to clear your NET or SET exams, and then finally you do it, no matter who rewards you or not, but it's very important for you to reward your own self, because it's you who's worked hard so much. It's you who's attempted so many times, and you've come out with such a wonderful score. So it's very important to reward yourself. So you need to be kind to yourself, and you need to motivate yourself to have a healthy emotional development. Now, this is the most important part, I would say, empathy. Now, empathy is very, very, very different from sympathy. Empathy is...
Yes. Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am.
Yes.
Could you please enlarge your screen, ma'am?
I'm sorry?
Could you please make it full, ma'am?
It's not full?
No, ma'am.
This is fine?
Maybe from your PDF, I think below that...
You want me to do this?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Most welcome. So, empathy is most important element in emotional intelligence. And empathy is the ability to understand the wants and needs and the viewpoints of those around you. It's not about the self. It's more about the people around you, how you understand people. And once you understand people, you crack the solution. You will be able to deal with everybody in a very constructive and a very beneficial manner. So very empathetic people understand others' feelings and are excellent in managing relationships, listening and relating to others. The people who are empathetic, they do not judge and they do not stereotype. So empathy is seeing with the eyes of another, listening with the ears of another, and feeling with the heart of another. Hope the pictures over here explains you what empathy is. Empathy is understanding. Oh yes, I understand this is the pain you're going through. Oh yes, I can feel how you might be feeling with this loss. So this is what empathy is. Empathy helps the person to be understood, and it makes the person to get up and move on with life. So the difference between empathy and sympathy here is, in empathy, we say, I feel your pain. But in sympathy, they say, I'm sorry that you're in pain. So in sympathy, you're keeping the person down, not lifting up the person. But in empathy, you tend to lift up the person, and the person feels very nice. For example, this is the best picture of the day, I would say, the empathy. The wife is pregnant. She's carrying the big tummy for 9 months. And the husband asks, how long do I have to hold this ball for? And she says, 9 months. Then only you will understand what truly a wife goes through. So, okay, one second. This is stuck. Let me get another slide. Okay, so now after empathy, let's talk about social skills. It's easily talking to others is a sign of high emotional intelligence. As I said, we can also say the people who are very extrovert, they have excellent social skills. They can manage their disputes. Like we have the person to go to when we say, okay, just call that person. They can just sort out our fights, or when you're good at your social skills, you can communicate excellently. The way I said, we need to have more clear, small talks to make people understand. And with strong social skills, they focus on helping to develop and others to develop and shine besides their own success. The people who have good social skills, they not only benefit themselves, they also benefit the others around. Now, social skills affects nearly every aspect of you. Yes. I'm sorry, just one second. Okay, maybe I'll have to make it a little small, Mr. Nagaraju, because the slide is getting beneath this and I'm not able to read the other side.
Okay, ma'am, you may please.
Yeah, we need to just keep it like this.
Yes, okay, ma'am, please.
So social skills affect nearly every aspect of your life, starting from your love life to the groups and clubs and home, meeting people, how you socialize at work, with your friends, sports teams and school or university. So social skills are very important, wherein it affects all your aspects of your life. So I think with this, we are done. And now we can have the question answer session for emotional development as well.
Yes, ma'am, we have some questions.
Yes.
So I'll read it for you, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, the first question related to this part.
Yes.
Does being introvert means the child mental health is not good?
Absolutely no. Because introvert is a type of personality. We can be perfectly normal plus introvert, not necessary.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is by Dr. Rubina Khan, ma'am. Is emotional question yes. fixed or can it be enhanced? Is emotional yes, question fixed or can it be enhanced?
Yes, I understand. She's asking whether emotional quotient is fixed or can we enhance it? Yes, we can enhance it. As in this slide, I told you how to enhance your emotional quotient by that's like the exercise and then this one. Like observe how you react to people and then look at your work environment, what triggers your irritability or frustrations, like examining yourself and then regulating your emotions will help you improve on your EQ. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. So next question is by Atiya Parvin, ma'am.
Yes.
Person who have high emotional intelligence is self-regulated?
Absolutely right. They are very in control of themselves. They can regulate their emotions. Even if they're extremely angry, they can put a smile on their face and say, oh, I'm good. Maybe I will talk to you later. I have to hurry and I have to go somewhere else for a meeting. So they will not even make you feel that they were angry.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Faiza Altaf, teacher. So are extrovert persons more emotionally intelligent than introvert? That is the question.
Yes, that's a nice question. Not necessary, again, to tell you their personality types, introverts, extroverts, and there's something called ambiverts in between. So everybody has their own emotional intelligence and IQs, but this is a personality type. I choose not to socialize much. The same person, the other person might choose to socialize more, but it doesn't say that they're more intelligent. Even introverts, maybe you can see back in school, we had in our classrooms, maybe that one boy or that one girl who were very quiet, but then they had their grades and distinction, and they always passed with first grade. So they're not social. They're very introvert, but still they're very intelligent.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question by Nisar Hussain Saab.
Yes.
How can we keep emotional health active in this COVID period? Please give some suggestions. So related to present situation, ma'am.
Absolutely right. This is very, very important because I as a counselor, psychologist, I see many good, happy-go-lucky people going very, very emotionally low because of the COVID situation. Now, to start off with, it's very important for us to be flexible, as I told you, and to be accepting to the change. Yes, COVID-19 has struck the whole world. Everything is changing. Children are not going to school. We are just in one room with our laptops doing our jobs. So it's, yes, I understand. It's very heavy on us because we love to be social. We love to be outdoors. We love doing our jobs. But then at this point of time, to start with, is to take care of yourself physically. You need to exercise. You need to eat healthy to keep your mental development healthy. You need to educate yourself and you try accepting things and try doing things. At least, you know, end of the day, we have to be grateful for what we are able to do. Still, if we do not get infected with COVID, we need to be thankful that, okay, still we are alive. So being grateful is the most important thing. And when you're feeling low, everybody has their own tailored way of pulling themselves up. Try to stop, try to just relax, think, evaluate, reevaluate your thoughts. Try to train your mind that this is how it is going to be for another few months. So these are the things we can help ourselves with.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon. Hello.
Please, ma'am, please go ahead. Please ask, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You are.
Yeah, this is Saba Khatun from Manu, Hyderabad.
Okay.
First of all, I would like to thank you, ma'am, for such a calming discussion.
Yes.
I would like to ask you a question that you spoke about positive emotions and negative emotions.
Absolutely.
So sometimes we see that children express their positive and negative emotions, you know, simultaneously. They switch to, you know, from positive emotions to negative emotions more frequently. So what would be the reason behind that, ma'am?
See, as we are talking about children, it's very easy to make them happy and it's very easy to irritate them as well. So children do not have a lot of self-control. So that's the reason they are very, it's very easy for them to feel in a certain way. They cannot regulate their emotions. That's why even in the middle of the supermarket or in the middle of the party, the child will roll on the floor and throw tantrums for what he or she wants because they cannot regulate our emotions. So as adults, we would never do that. So this is something to do with self-control. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. Another question.
Yes.
If you would permit me.
Yes, please.
You also spoke about low EQ and high EQ, ma'am.
Yes.
So I would like to ask that how to deal with the person with low EQ. Would you please suggest some points to deal with such kind of personalities?
Right. Now, when you've realized that somebody is very low on emotional intelligence and that's why they are acting the way they are, maybe they're very aggressive or demanding or whatever it is. So the first thing what we need to do is being very empathetic towards them. The understanding is the key. So the moment you start understanding them, they'll start feeling very comfortable. And then you'll have to tailor your own approach towards them. Like when they're getting very aggressive, you have to communicate clearly to them that this aggression is not going to take us anywhere. So would you like to go take a walk, or would you like to do something which calms you down? And then can we get back to this conversation after some time? So if you can be more clear, we might discuss it on it. But on a general note, this is how we can deal with person with more empathy who are on a very low emotional intelligence. I hope I've answered the question.
Yeah, ma'am, thank you so much.
Most welcome. We can go in detail. You can have my number so that we can talk about this more. Yes.
Sure, ma'am. So please, ma'am.
I have a question, Rubina. Thank you very much. You delivered a very, very nice talk. And it was really very important for us to understand so many things. I have a question regarding this emotional intelligence level.
Yes.
You were saying that you have given certain parameters on emotional intelligence, like if you have low level or high level.
Yes.
So is there any scale on which we can measure our emotional intelligence?
Yes, there are many scales. There are many tests wherein your emotional intelligence can be tested, like the test we have for IQ levels. So yes, we have labs, we have tests wherein we can perform and get a score.
Can you provide us some tests so that we can use, or we can conduct these tests on our students in the class? And in our university, students from all sorts of backgrounds come. In every university, students from all sorts of background come. And there are, there are students who are very, very good in studies. They have, they are very passionate, and they have some aim for life. They want to become something. They are career minded. And then there are students who are not at all bothered about studies. They just want a degree. They are not motivated, and they are not understanding the importance of the studies. They are coming and going just like that. They just want passing marks, and they want to go away.
Right.
So in such situations, the people like us, the teachers.
Yeah.
It's difficult to deal with the class. Where there are students who are motivated and there are students who are not at all motivated.
Absolutely.
So, when I go to such a class, mm-hmm. I'm very excited. I prepare and, as a teacher, I want response from their side.
Right.
I want to know even when they are not understanding, if they have some language issue, if there is something, wrong with me as well.
Mm-hmm.
But, but there is no response from, they sit in the class with blank faces and they are not responding
to
the teacher. So in such a situation, motivation for the teachers, for the preparation of the class is also very important.
Oh, yes, absolutely right. I totally understand what you want to say, that it brings us down when we go prepare so well in the class and we have zero response from the students or very low response from the students. So it's a very tricky situation there. But then what you've asked for, the emotional test, I'm sorry, I cannot provide you. Maybe the counselor psychologist in your university, they have the access to the test. And we say those psychometric tests, she can order and then she can perform on whoever the students, which you can, if you would want to refer. So she would be the right person to do that. And also the other thing is, if the class is very demotivated, as you said, what we can do is we can try taking a constructive feedback from them. What you can do is you can give them papers. You can ask them what are the ways they want the class to be more interesting and keep it anonymous. They don't need to write their names on it. Like when I was doing my lectures and all, I used to do it more frequently with my students. I had in every class, we have this lot of students who are very naughty. They don't want to study and they will spoil the whole environment of the class. So we can actually give them more responsibility of attendance and involve them more in our work and try to personally hold them and also take a constructive feedback, like they want more of the PPTs or more of the videos or more of the interactive sessions or more of the guest lectures, or what do they like? More of the outdoor setting. There might be so many things. So that way you can help your students get motivated to be active in your class. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, yes, definitely. Yes. Thank you so very much.
Most welcome.
Yeah. We would invite you again.
Definitely. It would be a pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am. May I take another question, ma'am?
Yes, sure.
So this question is by Dr. Mohammad Kalimullah Saab.
Okay.
Is EQ and IQ correlated?
Yes, it is a little tricky, but yes, it is.
Okay, ma'am. Next question by...
In most of the cases, yes, it is. And it's. I cannot give you a concrete answer on it. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Hakim Ahmad Saab.
Yes.
Often teachers are asked to counsel the students.
Yes.
Is it that easy for everyone to do that?
I'm sorry, can you please say it again?
Sure, ma'am. Often teachers are asked to counsel the students.
Right.
Is that easy for anyone to do that?
Absolutely not, because to be very honest, we as teachers, we know how to teach a specific content or a specific we are facilitators. So for counseling, we need to be trained in it. So that's why we have counselors in our universities and colleges and schools. So referring the students to the counselors makes the job much easier rather than asking the teacher to directly counsel the student. Maybe on a personal level, if they are very good, the student and the teacher relation is good, then it's nice for the teacher to talk with the students. Otherwise, it's always to get on a little professional help would help more, I believe.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another question by Majid Chaudhary Saab.
Yes.
Ma'am, you talked about emotions and empathy.
Yes.
But there are certain subjects like mathematics. People say mathematicians are emotionless.
No, no.
So I'll continue my question. How to tackle it? We try a lot with our students, but sometimes they are unable to connect us due to this subject.
Please, this is a wonderful question. I appreciate this. See, we are all intelligent. So I know math is a very good subject, but then we are all intelligent in some or the other ways. Maybe I'm very good at math and logical thinking. Okay. And others are maybe very good at creative thinking, like being an artist, or the others are maybe very good at literacy. So the areas of intelligence. So if a person is teaching math and very good at his logical thinking, it sometimes gets a little difficult to understand the tricky emotions. So it's always good for the students to be referred to the counselor of the university.
Because
technically, I feel that people who are very logically intelligent, they can see only black and white. They don't see the gray areas in between. Sometimes you can also be right and I can also be right. But then for them, it's either black or white. So I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Welcome.
Next question by another teacher, Kahaful Warasab. Which types of fun activities help our students to learn,
mm-hmm.
to explore and regulate their emotions during COVID period, especially online interaction?
I'm sorry. In the online classroom, are you talking about?
Yes, ma'am, especially. I'll repeat me once again. Which types of fun activities help our students to learn, to explore and regulate their emotions during this COVID period, especially online interaction? Asking about different types of fun activities. What kind of fun activities can we use to regulate online classes related to emotions, he's asking.
Okay, so it's a little confusing for me. If I understand, is it this like you're asking me that what are the fun activities for the students to regulate their emotions?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now when we're talking about regulating our emotions, I'm sorry, I did not get the question. Can you again repeat?
Which types of fun activities help our students to learn, to explore and regulate their emotions during this COVID period, especially online?
See, now what I understand is he's asking whether to how to make the classes more fun and interactive with the students so that they learn better.
Yes, ma'am.
Especially when during this pandemic, when emotionally everybody is like technically very low, right? So first thing what I can say you is when you have an interactive session, when you're doing your online classes, what you can do is you can try new methods of learning. For example, if you have a topic, try make a PPT rather than just a monotonous lecture for 40 minutes or 60 minutes. And as you've seen, I have used so many pictures from here and there because this makes it a lot of fun because picture speaks louder. So you can use more of the pictures, you can use more of the videos to make the sessions more interactive. And also you can give them the responsibility. You can give away small topics and ask them to make PPTs and do it for the class. So in that way, you would be able to finish the portion. Plus they feel responsible. They do their research, they make their PPTs or videos. And when they're doing for the class, the other class also gets to learn at the same time. Your job is done at the same time. It's fun for them as well. And the second thing is you can Google and you can find out more. There's so many things to make the class, the classrooms interactive, especially the online ones. I hope you answered the question.
Thank you, ma'am. Well, you have answered, ma'am. So next question is by Mohammad Bahauddin Saab.
Yes.
Those who don't express their emotion controlling.
Yes.
Emotion controlling it, even when it is required.
Yes.
Are actually regulating their emotion and can we say they are emotionally matured? It's a long question, ma'am. I'll make it into bits. Those who don't express their emotion controlling, even when they when it is required, are actually regulating their emotion and can we say they are emotionally matured?
See, at the first place, if a person fails to control their emotions, that means they are very low on emotional intelligence, because the controlling part is very important. I'm sorry, would you want to repeat the question again? Because it's very contradictory.
Okay, ma'am. Sure. Those who don't express their emotion controlling.
Means he wants to say that the people who are not controlling their emotions.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
When it is required.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am.
Please ask, sir. I think
am I audible?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. Actually, I'm asking those who don't express their emotion controlling it. I mean, he's controlling his emotion and don't express. If that is required, sometimes expressing our emotion is required.
Yes.
In this situation, he's not expressing their emotion and controlling it.
Right.
Are actually regulating their, can we say that he is he or she is regulating their emotions and control, and can we say can we say he or she is emotionally mature?
Yes. What I understand is you're saying that if a person is not expressing their emotions, which has to be expressed at that point of time, so is that self-regulation? Is that
yes,
regulating themselves? Yes, they might not. They might choose not to express their emotions because they do not feel comfortable at the first place, or they do not want to face the consequences, or they're not interested in sharing the emotion at that point of time. Maybe after some time, or after giving, maybe. It also depends upon with whom they want to express. Like, we all do not express all our emotions in front of everybody. We choose. Even at our workplace, we have that one go-to person wherein we can go and tell everything. So, yes, the person who does not express, they are actually regulating themselves. I hope I've answered the question.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
If there's something else, please ask.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Most welcome.
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I'm Samina Tabasrum from Manu Hyderabad, Department of English.
Yes.
The presentation is very informative and interesting indeed.
Thank you.
I don't know if I've missed this point, but did you ever at any point comment upon the gender distinction in emotional intelligence?
No,
out of my experience, like I've seen that women are,
yes,
emotionally more intelligent than men. Has there any research been conducted to prove this? Because my female students seem to be more emotionally intelligent than my male students.
Okay, that's a nice question. Now, I would prefer not to gender stereotype here. Well, the thing is, scientifically, no, it's not been proved that women are more emotionally strong than men. It's nothing like that. The only thing is, on a very superficial layer, I would want to share this with you, that women are more expressive than men. But that doesn't mean that men are not emotionally intelligent. So I hope I've answered the question. Or do you have something to add?
Yeah. I would like to add that because expression is very important, because it's communication, and
yes,
effective communication leads to successful relationships.
Yes.
Women are more expressive, are
yes,
therefore effective communicators, and therefore have a tendency to manage relationships better. Am I right?
See, now what you're saying is right, but also I've seen many men who are more maybe, I would put in like this, yes, they are more, let's blame it to our society and our Indian tradition. Like, we don't let men to cry. We don't let boys to cry, saying that, oh, you're a boy, you're not crying. Oh, you're not a girl, and all of that. So technically we have made the men the way they are today. But then, even though in these modern times, I've seen men who are very good at communication, who are very good at expressing themselves, but majority of them, because of our traditions and our societal norms, they communicate less, so that there is less misunderstanding, there are less fights, domestic fights. I'm sorry if I'm right. I think all the men here agree with me. So there's nothing to do with gender, my dear. It's most it's mostly about the culture, because the men abroad have seen they're very communicative, they're very clear, they handle the relationships very well. Even our Indian men, they choose not to express most of the times, to keep things a little low profile and to, you know, gel with the situations. So it depends technically. But yes, okay. Women are more expressive because yes. Women love to talk, and that's how women deal with the situations. When we are angry, when we are irritated, we want to share, we want to talk and talk and talk. And that's how we are made.
True. Thank you so much.
Most welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I think next one request is there for you, ma'am.
Yes.
Madam Sabha Khatun is asking your email ID to contact you if she gets any doubts. She may want to continue ask questions.
Okay. I will just write on this and.
Sure, ma'am.
Sorry, there is not. So is this visible? I hope.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Right, so you can, yeah. And I can, I don't mind sharing my number too. Yeah, that's my number and that's my email. You can feel free to contact me, but please do not call me after 7 in the evening. I hope we all respect our family time. And yes, you can WhatsApp me. I do take counseling sessions online. And anything, feel free to ask.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So next yes. question is by Madam Sayed Hajira. So please give some tips to overcome from COVID-19 anxiety.
COVID-19 anxiety, yes. This is very, very important. For now, the most important tip what I can give is eat healthy, work out, please bring up your immunity levels, because at the back of your mind, you will be at least 50% sure that, okay, even if I'm in contact, my immunity is high, I will not get infected. And then doing our daily jobs, trying to accept the change and just waiting for the vaccine or the treatment to come out is the best thing. And when you feel very, very anxious, try to do things what you like. Try to divert, try to distract your mind, train your mind in a way that, okay, from so many months, if I've not been infected, then why now? So pick up the triggers and work on it.
Thank you, ma'am.
The question, yes.
Next question by Mohammad Bahaduddin Saab.
Yes.
While dealing with a depressed or heartbroken person.
Okay.
And feeling with the client's heart might lead to depression or anxious.
I'm sorry. Dealing.
Yes, ma'am. I'll repeat, ma'am. While dealing with a depressed or heartbroken person.
Yes.
Feeling with the client's heart might lead to depression or anxious. This is the statement.
Mm-hmm.
So how can a sensitive teacher deal with the students in such situations with empathy?
Right. So if I did not understand the whole statement, to be very honest, but what I understood is if there's a student who has who's very heartbroken, who's very depressed, okay, first thing what you can do being empathetic towards him is to understand what he's going through, rather than saying that it's okay, it's a part of the life, you need to get up and go on. So we are not doing that. So listening is the most important skill here. And still, if the person is very, very low, let the child or the adult or the student, whoever it is, seek some professional help from the counselor. Because they're trained in a certain way wherein they will be able to cope up with the loss or with the grief they're going through. I hope I've answered the question. Please let me know.
Hello, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
I actually wanted to ask that you have mentioned every teacher must have empathy while dealing with his client or student. Being a teacher, suppose a situation where a student suffers from any kind of emotional disturbance, or he or she is heartbroken. In this situation, feeling from his or her heart, as you mentioned, while defining emotion, while defining empathy, empathy is feeling from another heart. While feeling another heart might lead, I'm saying that might lead to be in the same situation as when suffering from. So how can, what would you suggest for teacher in this situation? How should we be careful about?
Yeah, sir, what I understood is you're talking about...
Maybe...
Yes. Yes, please, I'm listening.
Yes, ma'am.
Please, sir, please go ahead, sir.
I actually wanted to ask, in a situation, someone is heartbroken or having some kind of emotional disturbance.
Okay.
In this situation, feeling from their heart might lead to the same situation. In
right.
This, maybe I become heartbroken or start feeling depressed or might be depressed. So in this situation, what would you suggest for a teacher? What would we be careful about?
Yes. May I know your name?
Mohammad Bahauddin, sir.
Mohammad Bahauddin.
Yes,
sir. I would. I understand your question. What I would request you is, could you email me the case so that I can give you more clearer solution on it? Because talking about heartbroken okay. depression is a very general thing what you're saying. So I cannot suggest you in a very proper way. So if you can email me on this address, I would be able to help you out with this, and we can always keep this confidential.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Mohammad Kalimullah Saab.
Yes.
Are EQ and IQ measurement scales trustworthy? I think Bahauddin Saab, please mute your mic, Saab. Ma'am.
Yes.
Are EQ and IQ measurement scales trustworthy, reliable, and valid?
Absolutely right. They are trustworthy. They're accurate. They're reliable. If whoever is buying it from the psychometric, these psychometric tests, they are absolutely reliable. We use it.
Oh, thank you, ma'am.
But not those which are on the internet and the Facebook and when you Google. So I do not take responsibility of that.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Omar Farooq Saab.
Yes.
Since emotional intelligence and development are very much affected by early age environment.
Absolutely right.
I think continuation is there, ma'am. Should we leave it assuming that as it is a matter of fate, or can we change our emotional intelligence and personality in later stages?
Yes. Now, to start with emotional intelligence, it is once, like, let me give you a brief on it. In a nutshell, babies are born and they start developing their emotions according to the parents, the environment in which they grow up, and the environment of the school. These are the early environments which teach the child. So once you're an adult and once you've realized that your emotions, the positive and the negative, and how well you're aware of them and how well you can regulate them, and if you are unable to, so yes, educating yourself, practicing, taking help of a psychologist, getting into a therapy will help you improve and enhance your emotional intelligence. Yes. We can. So we need not just leave it on the fate. So we can definitely help anybody at any stage of life. I hope I've answered the question.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, you are.
Yes.
So next question by Dr. Rubina Khan, ma'am.
Okay.
Intelligence is the ability to adapt and adjust with situations. So can we infer that more intelligent person will have more emotional intelligence?
Not necessary. These are two different subjects, and also intelligent people sometimes are low on regulating their emotions. So we cannot definitely say that high IQ people are emotionally very stable, because the people who are extremely high on IQ, especially the prodigy, the gifted ones, we say that there's a very thin line between extremely intelligent and madness. So not necessary that they are very good emotions and very stable. So I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I think next question is by Mohammad Kalimullah Saab. I think he has already asked other questions also.
Yes.
Ma'am, could you suggest some reliable and valid measurement scales for EQ and IQ?
Yes, I would love to suggest, but then this is, we cannot do it. It has to be done by a psychologist, because technically, as doctors are supposed to prescribe, not everyone can prescribe. So it's just a similar way. So I cannot give you the tests and say that you can take this test and assist yourself and do the scoring. So you need to get into in touch with a psychologist so that you can assess your whatever the areas you want to get evaluated on.
Thank you, ma'am. I think he's taken your point, ma'am.
Okay.
Next question is by Dr. Shehina Parvin, ma'am.
Yes.
Alongside self-assessment, there are several practical emotional intelligence exercises that help for better understand and develop emotional intelligence. Can you suggest that exercise?
I'm sorry, can you please repeat?
Sure, ma'am. Alongside self-assessment, there are several practical emotional intelligence exercises that help for better understanding and developing emotional intelligence. Can you suggest that exercise? Though are those exercises?
Yes. So what you can do is, as I told you, the emotional development, the emotional intelligence involves all these domains: the self-awareness, empathy, motivation, self-regulation, and social skills. So you can make a note of this, you can Google, you can learn more about it, how to regulate your emotions, how to keep the motivation thing I've told you here, how to motivate yourself, how to, like, the company matters, how motivation comes internally, how to reward yourself. At the same time, I've also spoken about empathy, how you need to improve, how you need to understand other people. And then I've also spoken about self-regulation, social skills. So you can read more about it to educate yourself. And there are so many other tips also on Google. You can type how to improve the social skills or how to learn regulating one's emotions. You have so much material, and I hope it would be very beneficial if you keep reading some of the other things. In this 60-minute session, I could just pick up the most important things and I could just put in here. So I hope if you just write down these domains of emotional intelligence and do a little more research, you'll be able to help yourself. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
And the slide is also visible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, it's visible.
Yes.
I think I request Arshad Ayub Saab to ask his question.
Okay.
It's actually a big, lengthy question.
Okay.
Arshad Ayub Saab, please unmute your mic and ask your question.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah. Actually, ma'am, I wanted to ask that theoretically we can discuss now that human beings, about human beings and different types of human beings. But we teachers can we as a teachers practically claim about a person that he or she is introvert or extrovert, or is a person with low EQ or high EQ? Considering the diverse differences we human beings have, and a person might be between these two extreme poles rather than just simply being introvert or extrovert, or a person with low EQ or high EQ. And my another question is, because can these characteristics of introvert, extrovert, high, low EQ also vary in a single person with different contexts, times and places, etc.? Because we also know the limitations of psychology, and there are many things to be explored about human brains and human minds.
Yes, so can we start with the first question? As you said, can we recognize people with being introvert or extrovert? So my answer to this is yes, we can recognize people who are introvert and extrovert. And most of you are not aware of something called ambivert, I guess, because nobody asked about this. So the majority of the people are ambivert, like we socialize at some places and so places we don't choose to. So those people are ambivert, those are average. So extremely interactive people are known as extroverts, and extremely non-interactive people are known as introverts. So yes, we can recognize people if the people are very social, very outgoing, very talkative, they can strike conversations very easily. Yes, they are extroverts. And the people who are very shy, who wants to sit at one place, not very responsive, they are introverts. So it's easy to recognize in a classroom situation or in any other settings that who are introverts and extroverts. And then the other half of the question was, may I ask you again?
My another question is that we can say that this person is introvert, this person is extrovert, but sometimes we see that on a given place, in a given time or place, or in a given context, a person, degree of being introvert or extrovert sometimes vary.
Yes, is it, absolutely.
And also, is it the same with low EQ or high EQ? Like you told us about the characteristic of low EQ and high EQ.
Yes.
But I found that characteristics I have from low EQ and some from high EQ.
Right. So, now, yes, I understood your question. I'm sorry. Do you want to add more to it?
No.
Okay. So this is a slide are you talking about?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So yes, see, now there are characteristics which are listed over here on a very general way. Like now people with low emotional intelligence, it's not that people with high emotional intelligence will not feel aggression or will not feel impulsive or will not feel critical. They do. They do feel angry. They do feel sometimes very critical about anything, but they know how to regulate it and how to positively communicate it, right? But the person, people with low emotional intelligence, they are generally very aggressive. They show it. They're demanding. They show it. They're bossy. They show it. So this is the difference between high and low emotional intelligence. I hope I've answered the questions.
Sure, ma'am. Actually, I also have another question.
Yes.
That suppose if today I am introvert, but
yes,
Tomorrow I am extrovert. Or maybe with seniors, I am introvert, but with juniors, I am extrovert.
Yes. See, I'll tell you one thing now, being introvert or being extrovert, this is a personality type. So we don't change. If you are a social person, you are social, like on most of the days of the year. Yes. They are for when you talk about your seniors or the people on a higher position. Now we cannot term it as an introvert, being introvert. We can term it as being more responsible in communicating and being more respectful. Whereas with our juniors or students or friends, we are on a very lighter note, we are more comfortable. So we talk anything and everything under the sun. So that's what it is. So if you're an extrovert, you are an extrovert. Or if you're an introvert, you are an introvert throughout your life mostly.
Excuse me, ma'am. Can I ask the question?
Sure, sure. Please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, is it important to or required to organize counseling sessions by the experts for the faculty members from time to time to focus and solve the problems related to the profession? Because I know many people of this profession who get emotionally and psychologically disturbed and taking regular medicines. By organizing such a counseling session, can we avoid such situations in future?
Yes. I'm sorry, what kind of medicines are you talking about? Like, can you give me more information about that?
Some pupils, I know some people of who are related to the teaching profession. Yes. They get psychologically disturbed and they are taking regular medicines by approaching the doctors, by recommended by the doctors.
What kind of medicines are they, those?
Actually, I don't know the exact name of the medicines, but if we organize the counseling sessions for the faculty members, then can we avoid such situations related to the stress of the profession?
Okay, to start with, teaching and training itself is a very strenuous process. And yes, there's a lot of stress involved in it. I agree to it. And by organizing, by taking professional help, and regularly educating yourself how to deal with the situations might lower your stress levels. And now the medicine you're talking about is it's an extreme level of stress wherein I feel very sorry for the person to go and take a medication for stress. So yes, working on the basics and working with the counseling sessions and trying to help each other should not let anybody go take medicines. If I'm, are you talking about stress-related medicines or something?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Stress-related medicines. There are some of my friends.
Really? Okay, so that's very extreme. So working at this level should help each other because, yes, teaching is a very stressful profession.
Okay. Then how it can be beneficial to organize counseling sessions for the faculty members?
Now, point one, what we can do is, now, whoever the faculty is, if the individual is feeling very low and unable to handle certain situations, certain classroom situations, or certain experiences with the management or any kind of problem with the colleagues, they can individually go take help from the counselor psychologist. This is the first thing they can do. And the second thing what we can do is we can have the group workshops like time and again. All of you as can, you know, try select topics and maybe weekly or bi-weekly we can have sessions on each of the topic and we can educate ourselves and help each other grow professionally and handle situations more effectively at the workplace. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much, ma'am.
You're welcome, dear.
Excuse me, ma'am. Yes. Samina Tabassum again. Yes. Yes, thank you for that idea of regular workshops for emotional intelligence. And it's not a question, but perhaps a suggestion. If there are authorities listening to us, like Kamal sir and Farida ma'am and others, we would the faculty would highly appreciate if there are regular workshops arranged for the faculty on emotional intelligence, because we all understand that emotional intelligence is increasingly becoming indispensable in every walk of life. Personal, social, professional.
Right.
And in fact, I would suggest that just as countries abroad, we can also start a 2-credit course, mandatory course on emotional intelligence for all the students, because everyone needs it to be, you know, to live a life happily.
To better, for the best.
For happiness, yes.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
I'm sure, like, to add on to it, even the students, like if there's a class or if there's a group of students who are very naughty in the class or something, so we can also organize different kind of motivating sessions for them as well. So apart from the faculty and the management and the students can also benefit with these kind of workshops. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. And not just workshop, I think a course, a mandatory course of at least 2 credits, because all the students need it, all of us need it.
Oh, yes.
So it's a life skill, just as we teach them communications, just as we teach them business communication or communication skills. Emotional intelligence is also a life skill, which should be taught at schools and higher education institutions.
Absolutely right. I agree to you. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, Sabina Tabassum, ma'am, for your suggestion.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, ma'am. So, ma'am, I think, can we go for further question, ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, this question is by Sabha Khatun, ma'am.
Yes.
How to deal with emotional intelligence of adolescents?
Yes.
Since they tend to be quite emotionally sensitive.
Absolutely right. So now when talking about adolescents, adolescents are the group of boys and girls who are getting mature physically and mentally as well. So they are very, very super sensitive and they have their own mood swings and they are on a very emotional roller coaster ride. So what I would suggest you is if you have an adolescent, we need to be more patient, we need to be more empathetic towards them, and we need to be more understanding. And in a nutshell, the most important thing is all the behaviors, maximum behaviors of the adolescents are temporary. It will not be carried on in adulthood. So whatever the new senses are, whatever the undesirable behavior your child or your student is showing, just keep calm and tell yourself that this is temporary stage and I need to just let this time go. Because physically, their body is working over time to grow. So they're like many, many other things. So this is the shortest and the clear answer to you. I hope I've answered the question. So you need to be patient. You need to be more understanding. And if you can allow certain wishes of themselves, let them just do it and get away.
Thank you, ma'am.
I think
next question will be by Dr. Mohammad Kalimullah Saab.
Yes.
Ma'am, could you suggest some courses and programs for counseling and psychotherapy? Those can be useful for teachers in school and college settings.
I'm sorry?
He's asking about the courses to be like, ma'am. Could you suggest some good courses and programs?
Yes.
For counseling and psychotherapy? Those can be useful for teachers in school and college settings.
Yes, for counseling, I will have to say that there are no short-term courses, as in there are diplomas out there where you can get it. One of the best diploma I can say the Francis is offering, St. Francis, and programs. Yes, now and then. There are workshops which come to educate, but then if you're from the psychological background, then it helps you a lot. So if you want to hold on to counseling, I would suggest you to get a nice diploma so you can be effectively using your skills with your students. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
I think I am. So now in the chat box, I think we don't have questions now.
Okay.
Maybe orally, I think participants can ask their questions. So I request the participants to ask questions if you have any. Ma'am, before that, I think I would like to ask one question to you, ma'am.
Yes, please.
I have observed even children and adults, they keep sulking regularly.
Yes.
So how to control that?
Yes. Can you be more? Yeah, we do sulk at times, and I think it's just being human. But how to pull ourselves back? That is more important. And also find out what makes you go hit so much low. Find the trigger. Find the thoughts which make you sulk. Time and again, we feel insecure, or maybe there's something out there which is making you, maybe an argument with your spouse, or maybe some kind of disrespect from somebody, or whatever it is. So find the trigger which makes you hit the rock bottom, then work on it to pull yourself up. And then after that, try to stay away from those triggers. You need to note down the triggers. What hits you down? What gets you so low? So that's how you can help yourself. Hope I've answered your question.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Most welcome.
So I request faculty to ask questions if you have any. So otherwise, if there are no any questions, we can wind up the session with the permission of the chair.
One question, ma'am.
Yes.
So do we conclude that there is no correlation between IQ and EQ?
Yes, I'm sorry. There's no, as I told you earlier, if a person is high on IQ, it's not necessary that he needs to be emotionally stable. Or if an person is very emotionally stable, he needs to be a very gifted or very high on IQ.
But we usually see that an intelligent person is able to successfully manage his or her emotions as well, because he's intelligent.
Not necessary, dear, because if it would have been like that, we wouldn't have a separate test for emotional quotient. We would have calculated everything in the IQ, that's intelligence quotient. So I can give you some examples, like we have many actors in our Bollywood wherein they have a very high IQ. They are very extremely talented in their art, but on an emotional level, they hit very low. That's why we have so many cases of suicides and so many cases of drug abuse. We have so many addicts and all of that. I hope I've answered the question.
Yes, but emotional intelligence is associated with productivity as well. Those who are emotionally intelligent are productive.
Yes.
So can we relate that productivity to their mental intelligence as well?
I'm sorry?
Because emotionally intelligent people are highly productive. Okay, they're highly motivated and they have high productivity.
Yes.
So isn't that again possible for us to relate it to mental intelligence? Aren't they somehow related?
See, emotionally intelligent people will organize, we'll set their boundaries, we'll be able to regulate their emotions in a better way and take their life in a very systematic way. Whereas when a person is on a very high IQ, whether it is logical thinking or creativity or literature or whatever it is, they might excel in their subject, but it's not necessary that they have a very organized life, they have a very productive life. It's not necessary, because I wouldn't want to take the names, but there are names of the people who you can Google and see they are very high on IQ. Maybe I can take one of this name. You can Google about Madonna, who is the singer. She has a very high IQ, but then at the emotional level, she had so many broken relationships, and yes, you can read her life history and then you'll be able to relate. No doubt she's produced amazing albums, amazing songs, people hear all over the world, but then she was very high on IQ, but then at an emotional level, she was very low.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Most welcome.
Can we take some more questions, ma'am, if there are any?
Yes.
Yes. So, participants, I think before we go for the end of the session,
Yes. I
think it's an opportunity to ask your questions. Please go ahead if you have any questions.
Ma'am, this is Mohammed Kalimullah.
Yes.
Please, sir. Go ahead.
Are you able? Very nice session, ma'am. We have learned a lot, ma'am, from your sessions.
Thank you very much.
I have one question that is not.
Sir, you are not audible. Could you please? Kalimullah sir, you are not Still audible.
Yes.
Please ask again, sir.
Yes, sir. Are you able to listen to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I'm asking this question is not directly related to this session, ma'am.
Okay.
But I think it is quite related to psychology.
Right.
So, ma'am, is language and thought related?
I'm sorry?
Is language and thought related?
Thought.
Language
and thought.
He's asking about relation between
thinking, ma'am.
Language and thought, madam. Thought.
Yes. Can you be more clear and can you be more concrete about your question, please?
Yes, ma'am. Some people think very well, but they cannot express well.
Express, yes, I understood. Yes.
But many researchers suggest that if I develop my thinking ability, I may be good in my language, in expressions. So why this why there is contradiction between these two? Some people can think well but cannot express well, but some researchers suggest that language and thought are correlated, and if I want to develop my language, I should also work on my thinking.
Right. So now, communication again is a very important skill. We all have to learn our communication skills. Many of us lack in our communication skills. That's why there are a lot of misunderstandings and there's a lot of communication gaps, and we are not able to express what we think. For example, when I ask you, how are you feeling today? We only have two answers, okay, fine or not fine. But we are not able to give the word to our feeling. We are not able to communicate our feeling. We are not able to communicate that. So we need to be more clear. So we need to be more, we need to work on it. It's a skill. For example, if you're the most common thing these days, what I come across is during my counseling sessions and people around, they say that they're very depressed. So I tell them, please do not use the word depression, because depression is again a clinical term which is diagnosed and which is given medicines for. So now it's become the way of expressing. Even if you're a little low, or you're upset, or you're uneasy, or you're not okay with certain things, you would say that, no, I'm feeling very depressed. So depressed is a very prolongated state wherein people even require effort to get up and brush their teeth. They're into the bed for like days together. So that's how people are communicating these days. So we need to find right terms. We need to work on our words and language to express our thoughts and our thinking. So it is very important. I hope I have answered the question. Thank you so much.